Thank you very much. So you can put your questions because the chat box is not visible. First, good afternoon. Today, the 13th of October is welcome. Basically, Python is again, whatever the sir is left, the many functions, absolutely correct. But I want to add more because in C and Python, I think you right now got the difference. C is a programming language. Python is basically a scripting language. What is the advantage that in Python you are getting? Basically, a program is nothing but data structure plus algorithm. Now, algorithm, it's, you know, you put it like English-like sentences. It's algorithm should have some input. Step one, step two, and then stop. And the programs, data should be in such a form so that it should be the intelligent form. In C, there is no such intelligent form. Only data you can put it in array, nothing like it. But here we have a string, we have tuple. The difference between tuple and string, you know, tuple is immutable, string is mutable. And so you're basically, where you put your data, that is very intelligent. Most intelligent is dictionary, where you can find it anything by calling a bigger key, the value is automatically coming. So that is it. So your advantage is whenever you put your data in intelligent way, then your program will be small and smaller. And then you are basically divide and conquer. Your whole program effort and everything is already a proven data structure, so intelligent data structure, so that your actual programming lines will be few. So that is the reason the development times will be much lesser, and it will quickly develop, and it will be rugged also, because all these data structure are built-in data structure, which is like mutable, immutable, dictionary, whatever, iterable. These things are not there at all. See, so everything you have to do by hand programming in that side, if you want the function, then there can be a mistake. So, but here, if you put all these intelligent things in the data structure part, if you have a default dictionary, if you have a set, and if you all these things, so these are all tested. These are all tested. Months of years of tested intelligent operations and set, and you just coding. Your coding will be less, and there will be and your development time will be quicker. And you know, though it will be slower than C++ function, but ultimately it will be faster that way, because it will, your development time is much quicker in effort, and also you can maintain it, because the original C++ program left the company, but Python is very readable code, and anybody can change it, you can upgrade it. So it is there is lots of advantages is there. I think that is some of the students asked me the question, what is namespace? Namespace is a crude example. Namespace is nothing like, we have two Amit. If you say one is Amit Datto and one is Amit Ghosh, so how to find which Amit? The Ghosh is the, and Ghosh Datto surname is basically namespace. Although it's crude, it's not good example. Same here, namespace is, you can create a namespace within namespace. Actual name should be unique, okay. And whenever you say name, there will be name with namespace. That should be unique. So I will show by the programming here. You see here is a global namespace, the local namespace. This is local namespace. You can see next. Yeah. Another beauty of it, from this space you cannot touch here, but from there you can access it here. So, like same in Java and C++, from this space you cannot see them. So, from this space you can access them. This is same as C++. Here, we see here, this example will show it. This is a count, 5, and there is a global count. If I do not make it, then this, there is no value. This is a global count. And count plus one, print count. Say here, this is the value, is from 667. Let's show in the screen itself. Do this in the. Is the screen visible? The screen, please. Screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Here the same program I am running. This program, don't worry, this program will be given to you in PDF form or text form, so that you can test it and develop it. I'll send this program. But a very easy program. This is, I declare a variable global count, say G count equal to 5, and another count, which is not global, but I in a global space, I don't declare it as global, but I the same count 9, and these are the method name. Here I declare this G count is a global, and G count to G count plus 1, and another count 0 is a local count. This count and this count is different. Count to count plus 1, print G count count, sum method, I call this method, then print, within this I print this, another print it. If you just run it, yeah. See here, first line is G1, 6, 9. Again, it has come 7-1. It will not take 9 value. This 9, within this, it will not take. Some method, it will take print count. Here, it will take the only 1. It doesn't take 9 plus 1, 10. So, there is a, one is, if you want to make a global variable, first of all, I will tell, don't take global variable. This is a very bad example. This is just to show you the effect of the environment, but in pure object-oriented programming, you don't need to take global variable, because global variable is the basic root cause of the program misbehavior. Because any global variable, we don't know who changes what, so everything can be done with parameter passing. Let's see. I think yes. So this is it now. This is another thing is def outer function 20, within this another inner function, this outer function. I think it is better, let's see here, we can, this is a function within a function we call, and we know another lambda function, that is anonymous function. Someday I have covered, or I will cover, in another class I have covered. So let's see, this is, we'll practice it. This will practice. This can be shown here also. Yeah. Here. Yeah. This is a function. Here I declare a 20 and another function a is 30. And this a is different, obviously. This a is local to it. Print a. So first print will be 30. Outer function, so then last 10 is equal to a is equal to 10. So here you see, this is the whole function. First, initially is a is equal to 10, print outer function. So here, outer function I call, when outer function a is again 20, okay, it goes to inner function print. The first print will be this one. First execution should be this one with value 30. So this is it. This is it. Okay. And then, what is the next print function? Then, outer function is okay. Then, inner function, print a is equal to this a, then the 20 will be printed. This way, 20 will be printed. Okay. And, yes, and then print a is equal to a, then 10 will be printed. Why? Because so A is different to different everywhere. Okay, this is not the same A. Okay. I think anything you have to not understood, please tell me. Should I go once more? I'll send this code. You should run it, then you can see it. All this code will be sent to you. Any question, please? This is same as a Java and C++. The from outside world you cannot reach inside. But inside, you can go outside. And the scope will be, the lowermost scope is the valid. If the same name is available at inner scope and outer scope, the inner scope will take over. Okay? Any question, please? Hello, student, please. Anyone? Anyone? Hello? Yes. Thank you. Am I visible? This screen is visible? Hello?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. Please, please respond. Whenever, because it's sometimes. Here, another interesting thing is, see, here we have an import math, import NumPy. So this pi is a namespace is with math, and this pi is namespace with NumPy, and you will see they are different. Let's see. If we run it, see here import math input. This is the print idea of math.py. This is math.py is a class float, and this is NumPy PI, that is a class float, but their object IDs are different. So what I want to see, what I want to impress upon you, so these are both pi, but their namespace is different, their object ID is different. Okay? Because this is a math.py and this is num.py, and how can you show the object ID? You always print ID, then you can see the object ID. Okay, so that is the namespace is here. Is this math module. So whenever you see the import NumPy, here I call by NumPy.py, and you can call by NP.py. Then you have to say import NumPy as NP. Then you can call NP.py, and that is the most practice standard short name, import NumPy as NP. But here, if you don't do it, that okay, then you should call the numpy.py. And here the map.py, and those pi are basically two physically distinct objects. How can you say they're distinct? Whenever you see the values are same, but their object IDs are different. Yes. Let's see anything else is there. Okay. Another thing I wish to show you. Yeah, I think it is one of our PPT. This is, list and dictionary. The list, if you want to find any element, you have to go each I one. So complexity is O N. N is the number of items. But in dictionary, if you give the key, it will find directly go to the key. So complexity is O one. That is a big advantage of dictionary. So most of the cases you go for dictionary, but one thing we have to compromise, the list, if we have a 20 values, we need only another 20 to keep it values, but dictionary, if we have a 20 values, we don't have to, we have to give at least 40 values, because whenever a dictionary key is there, so we have to make some hash operation may be a simple modulo operation, modulo 3 or modulo 4 or generally modulo 2, 8, 4. These operations are there, modulo 2, modulo 4. These are one kind of hash operation. This is the simplest hash operation. The remainder portion will take as a key. So if we have 19 values, we can go for a modulo 19 or modulo 17. We can go for modulo 17 or modulo 15. Should be a little bit of no common factors. So if you have a value put 20, you should not take modulo 10. We should take modulo 19. So 19 and 20 are mutually prime to each other. So we take the highest order. So we get the remainder portion as a key. So it is better that 20 values, instead of 20, we should have double amount of space. So it can be sparsely completed. So there will be no conflict of keys. Sometimes key can be conflict. In some keys will be conflict, say if you take modulo 19, if you 20, say 20 divided modulo 19 and 1 modulo 19 is the same remainder 1, so that is key conflict, and the two values should be take subsequent spaces, so there should be some vacant spaces, space complexity in dictionary is higher, but now the space is much more. Lots of RAMs are 4 GB, 8 GB, 6 GB. So, but it gives you O1 advantage. So, and dictionary can contain a dictionary. That is another advantage. And dictionary key values cannot be duplicated, but these values can be duplicated. Remember, these values can be duplicated. And key, because it cannot be, and it can be only immutable values, like basically integer, the tuple, string, these can be key. List cannot be a key value, and any mutable thing cannot be key value. All the data types in Python, you should remember whether it is a mutable or immutable. The immutable one, you can put it in a, as a key values here. And immutable, whenever you pass by a function, that is a call by value. And immutable, if you pass by a function or method, that is called the call by reference. So here, I think it is already, I have done it. I think this time you have done it, no? Okay, just give once more, no issue. This is call by value and call by reference. So list is call by reference, and this is call by value. This is, I show you the program. Yes, this is these are what I want to show today. I will cover little bit of bytes and byte array. What is the difference between bytes? Means in Python, give like a C-like view so that you can access as byte level, because Java everything is Unicode, but in Python, but sometimes bytes are very necessary, because all the programming languages other than Japanese and Chinese or Urdu, they take 8 bytes. So bytes is very this thing, and these bytes and what's the difference between bytes and byte array? Byte array is mutable, like in Java we have string immutable and string buffer is a mutable. Same thing is here in Python. Byte is immutable and byte array is mutable. And it's the same concept here. It is generally 256 you can at a stretch, and this is 256. What is the advantage of the binary bytes? It takes much lesser space. Otherwise, 2 bytes. Here is a single byte, so it is a compacting the space. And maybe if you I'll cover the next class. So difference between bytes and bytes array, I'll give you talk. So let's go some programming. Bytes and bytes array. Excuse me, just hold on. Yes. Yes. Screen is visible, please. Okay. Screen is visible. Anyone?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Please, always. Make some noise. Sometimes it's helpful. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So this one. You, whenever you give some byte array objects, here it is, you are giving a string, it is a basically string, it is a bytes, and you are giving how to give B, you give just give in front B, that is a byte, and here is a string, it is a string. So if you see here, type it here, and if you see the print type Y, what happens, you just see. First one, X, is a class bytes. So this is the first time you heard the class bytes. In our class, we are discussing class bytes. And this is the class Y is string. V is the bytes objects are immutable. Immutable sequence of single bytes. And this is the bytes object. This is. So this is immutable. And it is. Okay. So remember to refer to initialize. Byte objects, bytes or byte string, you should give B, and you always print and see it. This is one thing, and another I want to show you this one here. Just run the program. Here you can code in UTF-8, that is 8 bit, that is standard universal, and you can see it class bytes and Python bytes. It is initialized. I initialize it x. This is another way you can initialize x is equal to iterable for Python bytes UTF. And this is, you see, type x, print x is a Python bytes. So you this is because you have initialized with bytes. Okay, so that it will take lesser space. Lesser space, that is another advantage. You run it here. Yeah, you run it here. See string BBPMT underscore CAC 2023 encoding the string with unit and section byte array. So you refer with byte array. Here it is a byte that is changeable. Byte is not changeable, byte array 16, print array. You see the last is a BPPMT, last is like your C, 0 is added to show the end of the string. This is the convention of C, any string last 0 added, this is a class byte array. What is the advantage? Is closer space and compact. This is this thing I have already covered. This thing I covered. Okay, so what is the summary of today's talk is now you have to venture into the actual programming world, because here data structure is too powerful. So you have to utilize it, and whenever you are utilizing, then you can appreciate. Otherwise, learning and learning, that's only this might help you. So thank you, students, and I will send some more program and send it to you. I hope this program is this good for you. I will send the text copy the program to you. Any question you can raise to me, or anything I have to tell more in the next classes, which topic, like iterable, these are the things are not their range. This support is in object-oriented programming. It is there in Java also. We are more in import. It is both the things are there, object-oriented programming and procedural programming. Java only object-oriented programming, but Python object-oriented programming and procedural programming, and it is basically a scripting language. Why I say scripting language? Because always remember, Python is a dynamic typing, because your values, actual values, determined at the dynamic type. But it is strong type. If you want to convert, you have to convert with the dynamically type. So it will be running slower, but actually development time is much faster, and your data structure is too powerful, so you can make a beautiful code on this. Okay, any question, please?